SparkNotes Audio presents No Fear Shakespeare. Listen to Shakespeare's plays in all their brilliance and understand what every word means. Don't be intimidated by Shakespeare. These audio editions make the Bard's plays accessible and enjoyable. Each No Fear audio edition features the complete original text performed by a full cast, the complete play, updated in modern English, also performed by a full cast. Each recording is enhanced with sound effects and music to complete the audio experience. Each recording includes a PDF with a track directory of the original English production and the modern English production for ease of comparison. When Shakespeare's words make your head spin, this audio will help you sort out what's happening, who's saying what, and why. And now, Julius Caesar. Characters. Julius Caesar, a great Roman general who has recently returned to Rome after a military victory in Spain. Julius Caesar is not the main character of the play that bears his name. Brutus has over four times as many lines, and the play does not show us Caesar's point of view. Nonetheless, virtually every other character is preoccupied with Caesar, specifically with the possibility that Caesar may soon become king. If Caesar were to become king, it would mean the end of Rome's republican system of government, in which senators, representing the citizens of Rome, wield most of the power. To noblemen like Brutus and Cassius, who considered themselves the equals of Caesar or any other citizen, Caesar's coronation would mean they would no longer be free men, but rather slaves. Caesar never explicitly says that he wants to be king. He even refuses the crown three times in a dramatic public display. But everything he says and does demonstrates that he regards himself as special and superior to other mortals. In his own mind, he seems already to be an absolute ruler. Brutus, a high-ranking, well-regarded Roman nobleman who participates in a conspiracy to assassinate Caesar. Brutus is motivated by his sense of honor, which requires him to place the good of Rome above his own personal interests or feelings. Thus, he plots against Caesar in order to preserve the Republic, even though he loves and admires Caesar personally. While the other conspirators act out of envy and rivalry, only Brutus truly believes that Caesar's death will benefit Rome. Brutus's sense of honor is also his weakness, as he tends to assume that his fellow Romans are as high-minded as he is, which makes it easy for others to manipulate him. Antony, a loyal friend of Caesar's. In contrast to the self-disciplined Brutus, Antony is notoriously impulsive and pleasure-seeking, passionate rather than principled. He is extremely spontaneous and lives in the present moment. As resourceful as he is unscrupulous, Antony proves to be a dangerous enemy of Brutus and the other conspirators. Cassius, a talented general and longtime acquaintance of Caesar. Cassius resents the fact that the Roman populace has come to revere Caesar almost as a god. He slyly leads Brutus to believe that Caesar has become too powerful and must die, finally converting Brutus to his cause by sending him forged letters claiming that the Roman people support the death of Caesar. Impulsive and unscrupulous like Antony, Cassius harbors no illusions about the way the political world works. A shrewd opportunist, he acts effectively but lacks integrity. Octavius, Caesar's adopted son and appointed successor. Octavius, who had been traveling abroad, returns after Caesar's death, then joins with Antony and sets off to fight Cassius and Brutus. Antony tries to control Octavius's movements, but Octavius follows his adopted father's example and emerges as the authoritative figure, paving the way for the eventual seizure of the reins of Roman government. Casca, one of the conspirators. Casca is a tribune, an official elected to represent the common people of Rome, who resents Caesar's ambition. A rough and blunt-speaking man, Casca relates to Cassius and Brutus how Antony offered the crown to Caesar three times, and how each time Caesar declined it. Casca insists, however, that Caesar was acting, manipulating the populace into believing that he has no personal ambition. Casca is the first to stab Caesar. Calpurnia, Caesar's wife. Calpurnia invests great authority in omens and portents. She warns Caesar against going to the Senate on the Ides of March, for she has had terrible nightmares and heard reports of many bad omens. Portia, Brutus's wife and the daughter of a noble Roman, Cato, who took sides against Caesar. Portia, accustomed to being Brutus's confidant, is upset to find him so reluctant to speak his mind when she finds him troubled. Flavius and Marellus, two tribunes who condemn the plebeians for their fickleness in cheering Caesar when once they cheered for Caesar's enemy, Pompey. Flavius and Marellus are punished for removing the decorations from Caesar's statues during Caesar's triumphal parade. Cicero, a Roman senator renowned for his oratorical skill. Cicero speaks at Caesar's triumphal parade. He later dies at the order of Antony, Octavius, and Lepidus. Lepidus, the third member of Antony and Octavius's coalition. Though Antony has a low opinion of Lepidus, Octavius trusts Lepidus's loyalty. Decius, a member of the conspiracy. Decius convinces Caesar that Calpurnia misinterpreted her dire nightmares and that, in fact, no danger awaits him at the Senate. Decius leads Caesar right into the hands of the conspirators. Act 1, Scene 1. Enter Flavius, Marellus, a carpenter, a cobbler, and certain other commoners over the stage.
Hence! Home, you idle creatures! Get you home! Is this a holiday? What, know you not, being mechanical, you ought not walk upon a laboring day without the sign of your profession? Speak, what trade art thou?
Why, sir, a carpenter.
Where is thy leather apron and thy rule? What dost thou with thy best apparel on? You, sir, what trade are you?
Truly, sir, in respect of a fine workman, I am but, as you would say, a cobbler.
But what trade art thou? Answer me directly.
A trade, sir, that I hope I may use with a safe conscience, which is, indeed, sir, a mender of bad souls.
What trade, thou knave, thou naughty knave, what trade?
Nay, I beseech you, sir, be not out with me. Yet, if you be out, sir, I can mend you.
What meanst thou by that? Mend me, thou saucy fellow?
Why, sir, cobble you.
Thou art a cobbler, art thou?
Truly, sir, all that I live by is with thee all. I meddle with no tradesmen's matters nor women's matters, but withal I am indeed, sir, a surgeon to old shoes. When they are in great danger, I recover them. As proper men as ever trod upon neat's leather have gone upon my handiwork.
But wherefore art not in thy shop today? Why dost thou lead these men about the streets?
Truly, sir, to wear out their shoes to get myself into more work. But indeed, sir, we make holiday to see Caesar and to rejoice in his triumph.
Wherefore rejoice? What conquest brings he home? What tributaries follow him to Rome to grace in captive bonds his chariot wheels? You blocks, you stones, you worse than senseless things. Oh, you hard hearts, you cruel men of Rome. Knew you not Pompey? Many a time and oft have you climbed up to walls and battlements, to towers and windows, yea, to chimney tops, your infants in your arms, and there have sat the livelong day with patient expectation to see great Pompey pass the streets of Rome. And when you saw his chariot but appear, have you not made an universal shout that Tiber trembled underneath her banks to hear the replication of your sounds made in her concave shores? And do you now put on your best attire? And do you now cull out a holiday? And do you now strew flowers in his way that comes in triumph over Pompey's blood? Be gone. Run to your houses, fall upon your knees, pray to the gods to intermit the plague that needs must light on this ingratitude.
Go, good countrymen, and for this fault assemble all the poor men of your sort, Draw them to Tiber banks and weep your tears into the channel to the lowest stream do kiss the most exalted shores of all.
Exeunt carpenter, cobbler, and all the other commoners.
See whether their basest metal be not moved. They vanish tongue-tied in their guiltiness. Go you down that way towards the capital. This way will I. Disrobe the images if you do find them decked with ceremonies.
May we do so? You know it is the Feast of Lupercal.
It is no matter. Let no images be hung with Caesar's trophies. I'll about and drive away the vulgar from the streets. So do you too, where you perceive them thick. These growing feathers plucked from Caesar's wing will make him fly an ordinary pitch. Who else would soar above the view of men and keep us all in servile fearfulness?
Exeunt severally. Act 1, Scene 2. Flourish. Enter Caesar, Antony, dressed for the course, Calpurnia, Portia, Decius, Cicero, Brutus, Cassius, Casca, and a soothsayer in a throng of plebeians. After them, Marellus and Flavius.
Calpurnia!
Peace, so! Caesar speaks!
Calpurnia!
Here, my lord.
Stand you directly in Antonius' way when he doth run his course. Antonius!
Caesar, my lord.
Forget not in your speed, Antonius, to touch Calpurnia, for our elders say the baron, touched in this holy chase, shake off their sterile curse.
I shall remember. When Caesar says do this, it is performed.
Set on! And leave no ceremony out.
Caesar!
Ha! Who calls?
Bid every noise be still. Peace! Yet again!
Who is it in the press that calls on me? I hear a tongue, shriller than all the music, cry, Caesar! Speak! Caesar is turned to hear.
Beware the Ides of March.
What man is that?
A soothsayer bids you beware the Ides of March.
Set him before me. Let me see his face.
Fellow, come from the throng. Look upon Caesar.
Soothsayer approaches.
What sayst thou to me now? Speak once again.
Beware the Ides of March.
He is a dreamer. Let us leave him. Pass!
Senate, exeunt. Monant, Brutus, and Cassius.
Will you go see the order of the course?
Not I.
I pray you do.
I am not gamesome. I do lack some part of that quick spirit that is in Antony. Let me not hinder, Cassius, your desires. I'll leave you.
Brutus, I do observe you now of late. I have not from your eyes that gentleness and show of love as I was wont to have. You bear too stubborn and too strange a hand over your friend that loves you.
Cassius, be not deceived. If I have veiled my look, I turn the trouble of my countenance merely upon myself. Vexed I am of late with passions of some difference, conceptions only proper to myself which give some soil perhaps to my behaviors. But let not therefore my good friends be grieved, among which number, Cassius, be you one, nor construe any further my neglect, than that poor Brutus, with himself at war, forgets the shows of love to other men.
Then, Brutus, I have much mistook your passion, by means whereof this breast of mine hath buried thoughts of great value, worthy cogitations. Tell me, good Brutus, can you see your face?
No, Cassius, for the eye sees not itself, but by reflection, by some other things.
'Tis just. And it is very much lamented, Brutus, that you have no such mirrors as will turn your hidden worthiness into your eye, that you might see your shadow. I have heard where many of the best respect in Rome, except immortal Caesar, speaking of Brutus and groaning underneath this age's yoke, have wished that noble Brutus had his eyes.
Into what dangers would you lead me, Cassius, that you would have me seek into myself for that which is not in me?
Therefore, good Brutus, be prepared to hear. And since you know you cannot see yourself so well as by reflection, I, your glass, will modestly discover to yourself that of yourself which you yet know not of. And be not jealous on me, gentle Brutus. Were I a common laugher, or did use to stale with ordinary oaths my love to every new protester, if you know that I do fawn on men and hug them hard, and after scandal them, or if you know that I profess myself in banqueting to all the rout, then hold me dangerous.
Flourish and shout within.
What means this shouting? I do fear the people choose Caesar for their king.
Guy, do you fear it? Then must I think you would not have it so?
I would not, Cassius. Yet I love him well. But wherefore do you hold me here so long? What is it that you would impart to me? If it be aught toward the general good, set honor in one eye and death in the other, and I will look on both indifferently. For let the gods so speed me as I love the name of honor more than I fear death.
I know that virtue to be in you, Brutus, as well as I do know your outward favor. Well, honor is the subject of my story. I cannot tell what you and other men think of this life, but for my single self, I had as lief not be as live to be in awe of such a thing as I myself. I was born free as Caesar, so were you. We both have fed as well, and we can both endure the winter's cold as well as he. For once upon a raw and gusty day, the troubled Tiber, chafing with her shore, Caesar said to me, "Darest thou, Cassius? Now leap in with me into this angry flood and swim to yonder point." Upon the word, accoutred as I was, I plunged in and bade him follow. So indeed he did. The torrent roared, and we did buffet it with lusty sinews, throwing it aside and stemming it with hearts of controversy. But ere we could arrive the point proposed, Caesar cried, "Help me, Cassius, or I sink." I, as Aeneas, our great ancestor, did from the flames of Troy upon his shoulder the old Anchises bear, so from the waves of Tiber did I the tired Caesar. And this man is now become a god, and Cassius is a wretched creature, and must bend his body if Caesar carelessly but nod on him. He had a fever when he was in Spain, and when the fit was on him, I did mark how he did shake. 'Tis true, this god did shake. His coward lips did from their color fly, and that same eye whose bend doth awe the world did lose his luster. I did hear him groan. Aye, and that tongue of his that bade the Romans mark him and write his speeches in their books. "Alas," it cried, "give me some drink, Titinius, as a sick girl." Ye gods, it doth amaze me, a man of such a feeble temper should so get the start of the majestic world and bear the palm alone.
Shout within, flourish.
Another general shout. I do believe that these applauses are for some new honors that are heaped on Caesar.
Why, man, he doth bestride the narrow world like a colossus, and we petty men walk under his huge legs and peep about to find ourselves dishonorable graves. Men at some time are masters of their fates. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves that we are underlings. Brutus and Caesar. What should be in that Caesar? Why should that name be sounded more than yours? Write them together, yours is as fair a name. Sound them, it doth become the mouth as well. Weigh them, it is as heavy. conjure with them, Brutus will start a spirit as soon as Caesar. Now in the names of all the gods at once, upon what meat doth this our Caesar feed, that he is grown so great? Age, thou art shamed. Rome, thou hast lost the breed of noble bloods. When went there by an age, since the great flood, but it was famed with more than with one man? When could they say till now that talked of Rome, that her wide walks encompassed but one man? Now is it Rome indeed, and Rome enough, when there is in it but one only man? O, you and I have heard our fathers say, there was a Brutus once that would have brooked the eternal devil to keep his state in Rome as easily as a king.
That you do love me, I am nothing jealous. What you would work me to, I have some aim. How I have thought of this and of these times I shall recount hereafter. For this present, I would not, so with love I might entreat you, be any further moved. What you have said, I will consider. What you have to say, I will with patience hear, and find a time both meet to hear and answer such high things. Till then, my noble friend, chew upon this. Brutus had rather be a villager than to repute himself a son of Rome under these hard conditions as this time is like to lay upon us.
I am glad that my weak words have struck but thus much show of fire from Brutus.
Enter Caesar and his train, which includes Casca.
The games are done and Caesar is returning.
As they pass by, pluck Casca by the sleeve. And he will, after his sour fashion, tell you what hath proceeded worthy note today.
I will do so. But look you, Cassius, the angry spot doth glow on Caesar's brow, and all the rest look like a chidden train. Calpurnia's cheek is pale, and Cicero looks with such ferret and such fiery eyes as we have seen him in the Capitol being crossed in conference by some senators.
Casca will tell us what the matter is.
During the exchange between Caesar and Antony, Brutus pulls Casca by the sleeve.
Antonio.
Caesar.
Caesar, aside to Antony.
Let me have men about me that are fat, sleek-headed men, and such as sleep o' nights. Yon Cassius has a lean and hungry look. He thinks too much. Such men are dangerous.
Antony, aside to Caesar.
Fear him not, Caesar. He's not dangerous. He is a noble Roman and well given.
Caesar, aside to Antony.
Would he were fatter. But I fear him not. Yet, if my name were liable to fear, I do not know the man I should avoid so soon as that spare Cassius. He reads much. He is a great observer, and he looks quite through the deeds of men. He loves no plays as thou dost, Antony. He hears no music. Seldom he smiles, and smiles in such a sort as if he mocked himself and scorned his spirit that could be moved to smile at anything. Such men as he be never at heart's ease whilst they behold a greater than themselves, and therefore are they very dangerous. I rather tell thee what is to be feared than what I fear, for always I am Caesar. Come on my right hand, for this ear is deaf, and tell me truly what thou thinkst of him.
Senate. Exeunt Caesar and all his train, except Casca. Casca to Brutus.
You pulled me by the cloak? Would you speak with me?
Aye, Casca. Tell us what hath chanced today that Caesar looks so sad.
While you were with him, were you not?
I should not then ask Casca what had chanced.
Why, there was a crown offered him. And being offered him, he put it by with the back of his hand,
thus.
And then the people fell a-shouting.
What was the second noise for?
Why, for that too.
They shouted thrice. What was the last cry for?
Why, for that too.
Was the crown offered him thrice?
Aye, marry, was it. And he put it by thrice, every time gentler than other, and at every putting by, mine honest neighbors shouted.
Who offered him the crown?
Why, Antony.
Tell us the manner of it, gentle Casca.
I can as well be hanged as tell the manner of it. It was mere foolery. I did not mark it. I saw Mark Antony offer him a crown. Yet 'Twas not a crown, neither. 'Tis one of these, coronets. And as I told you, he'd put it by once. But for all that, to my thinking, he would fain have had it. Then he offered it to him again, then he put it by again. But to my thinking, he was very loath to lay his fingers off it. And then he offered it the third time. He put it the third time by, and still, as he refused it, the rabblement hooted and clapped their chapped hands and threw up their sweaty nightcaps and uttered such a deal of stinking breath because Caesar refused the crown that it had almost choked Caesar, for he swooned and fell down at it. And for mine own part, well, I durst not laugh for fear of opening my lips and receiving the bad air.
But soft, I pray you. What, did Caesar swoon?
He fell down in the marketplace and foamed at mouth and was speechless.
'Tis very like he hath the falling sickness.
No, Caesar hath it not. But you and I and honest Casca, we have the falling sickness.
I know not what you mean by that, but I am sure Caesar fell down. If the tag-rag people did not clap him and hiss him according as he pleased and displeased them, as they used to do the players in the theater, I am no true man.
What said he when he came unto himself?
Mary, before he fell down, when he perceived the common herd was glad he refused the crown, he plucked me ope his doublet and offered them his throat to cut. And I had been a man of any occupation. If I would not have taken him at a word, I might go to hell among the rogues. And so he fell. When he came to himself again, he said, if he had done or said anything amiss, he desired their worships to think it was his infirmity. 3 or 4 wenches where I stood cried, alas, good soul, and forgave him with all their hearts. But there's no heed to be taken of them. If Caesar had stabbed their mothers, they would have done no less.
And after that, he came thus sad away.
Aye.
Did Cicero say anything?
Aye. He spoke Greek.
To what effect?
Man, I tell you that, I'll ne'er look you in the face again. But those that understood him smiled at one another and shook their heads. But for my own part, it was Greek to me. I could tell you more news, too. Marellus and Flavius, for pulling scarves off Caesar's images, are put to silence. Very well. It was more foolery yet, if I could remember it.
Will you sup with me tonight, Casca?
No, I am promised forth.
Will you dine with me tomorrow?
If I be alive and your mind hold and your dinner worth the eating.
Good. I will expect you.
Do so. Farewell, both.
Exit Casca.
What a blunt fellow is this grown to be. He was quick metal when he went to school.
So is he now in execution of any bold or noble enterprise, however he puts on this tardy form. This rudeness is a sauce to his good wit, which gives men stomach to digest his words with better appetite.
And so it is. For this time, I will leave you. Tomorrow, if you please to speak with me, I will come home to you. Or if you will come home to me, and I will wait for you.
I will do so. Till then, think of the world.
Exit Brutus.
Well, Brutus, thou art noble. Yet I see thy honorable mettle may be wrought from that it is disposed. Therefore it is meet that noble minds keep ever with their likes. For who so firm that cannot be seduced? Caesar doth bear me hard, but he loves Brutus. If I were Brutus now, and he were Cassius, he should not humor me. I will this night, in several hands, and at his windows throw, as if they came from several citizens, writings all tending to the great opinion that Rome holds of his name, wherein obscurely Caesar's ambition shall be glanced at. And after this, let Caesar seat him sure, for we will shake him, for worse days endure.
Exit.
Thank you.
Act 1, Scene 3. Thunder and lightning. Enter Casca and Cicero.
Good even, Casca. Brought you Caesar home? Why are you breathless? And why stare you so?
Are not you moved? When all the sway of earth shakes like a thing unfirm? Oh, Cicero. I have seen tempests when the scolding winds have rived the knotty oaks. And I have seen the ambitious ocean swell and rage and foam to be exalted with the threatening clouds, but never till tonight, never till now, did I go through a tempest dropping fire. Either there is a civil strife in heaven, or else the world, too saucy with the gods, incenses them to send destruction.
Why? Saw you anything more wonderful?
A common slave. You know him well by sight, held up his left hand, which did flame and burn like 20 torches joined, and yet his hand, not sensible of fire, remained unscorched. Besides, I have not since put up my sword against the capital. I met a lion who glared upon me and went surly by without annoying me, and they were drawn upon a heap 100 ghastly women, transformed with their fear, who swore they saw men all in fire walk up and down the streets. And yesterday, the bird of night did sit even at noonday upon the marketplace, hooting and shrieking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.